We have an outstanding lineup of speakers today. All participants will be muted on this webinar, but we will take questions and answers at the very end, so you can submit your questions either through Microsoft Teams in the Q&A section, or you can email your questions to Tam or Linda, and we will try to address these at the very end of this presentation. This recording will also be available in a few days, and you will all get a link to this. Don't forget to claim your CME. I won't read all of this. Everyone is familiar with how to do that. So I think in the interest of time, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Ruderman.
Appreciate the chance to speak to you today. The agenda says I'm talking about cytokine storm syndrome, and I'm going to cover that, but also some other aspects of this disease in our patients with rheumatic diseases. If we can go to the next slide. So one of the things that we've seen very early on with disease is this concept of cytokine storm syndrome. What I've laid out in this slide is a sort of group of syndromes that share a lot of similar features. Macrophage activation syndrome is a rare, although not terribly rare, concept that we've known for a long time in rheumatology in our patients with juvenile inflammatory arthritis, and more recently have begun to see it or recognize it in patients with Still's disease, adult onset Still's disease, even some lupus patients and other patients with connective tissue disease. Hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, or HLH, is a either familial or often induced disease by either malignancy or infection. And then we have known this cytokine release syndrome that's been seen with CAR T cell therapy and malignancy. And they all share a number of features, but fundamentally, all of these are variations on a theme in which there is a sort of unregulated and dysregulated overactivation of the immune system. Symptomatically, all of these different syndromes share fever, cytopenias, coagulopathies, transaminitis, multi-organ system failure, including ARDS, and I think all of us will recognize many of those as features of the COVID-19 infection, and some of which we'll talk about today. Over the years, we've learned that this syndrome is mediated in all these different cases by a combination of cytokine activation, including interleukin-1, interleukin-6, interleukin-18, and interferon gamma. And I've highlighted interleukin-1 and interleukin-6 because we actually have therapies directed at those specific cytokines. Next slide. On this slide, I pulled a couple of graphics from a couple of very recent papers. Obviously, with this infection, everything is very recent. The sort of cartoon on the left shows sort of the constellation of syndromes that fall under this umbrella, from the macrophage activation syndrome associated with systemic JIA on the right to some of the other things, and including in that red circle on the bottom, the associated cytokine storm syndrome that's seen with COVID-19. The table on the right, which comes up a little small, but on the far right, you see a lot of the features of the COVID-19 syndrome that share some of the things that we see in this case with HLH. Now, HLH was recognized a number of years ago. There are some classification criteria, and there's something called an H-score, which predicts prognosis. These were developed specifically for HLH that was not associated with malignancy or infection, so you have to be a little bit cautious about using all these, but it highlights a lot of the different features that are seen across this syndrome. And what you see on the right are a number of the things, including fever, anemia, thrombocytopenia, other cytopenias that we see with COVID-19. Next slide. Management of this, particularly in the COVID-19 setting, can be complicated. The first issue is trying to recognize which patients develop this syndrome. These are the patients that get profoundly ill. These are the patients with a multi-organ system failure, the patients who wind up in the ICU and often on the ventilator support with ARDS. Diagnosis can be sort of attempted with a number of lab abnormalities, in particular elevated CRP, elevated ferritin, although the ferritin levels seen with the COVID-19 infection don't seem to be the same sort of dramatic increases seen in some of the other syndromes in this spectrum. elevations in LDH, D-dimer, we've talked about at previous grand rounds, and cytopenias. The other issue in terms of management is trying to figure out if you want to address this particular syndrome. In other words, if you want to try to intervene to prevent some of the late stage and more serious complications of infection, when is the appropriate timing of intervention? And like so much with this disease, we're still learning on the fly. Is this appropriate to analyze and identify all hospitalized patients, just patients who are sick enough to be in the ICU, patients who require ventilatory support, or are they perhaps too late in the spectrum in this syndrome? Over the years, for all the diseases in this constellation, the mainstays of therapy have been glucocorticoids, intravenous immunoglobulin, interleukin-1 and interleukin-6 inhibition, and there are a number of therapies that do that. And particularly in the children with the JIA-associated macrophage activation syndrome, cyclosporine A. Early on, some open-label trials of tocilizumab in China suggested benefit. That's an IL-6 receptor antibody that interrupts IL-6 signaling, suggested some benefit. And in fact, tocilizumab was approved for the treatment guidelines of COVID-19 in China quite early on. A number of additional clinical trials are now ongoing. There are trials with tocilizumab, again, an IL-6 receptor antibody, sarilumab, another IL-6 receptor antibody, and I've highlighted that here because that trial is ongoing here at Northwestern. Cetuximab, which is an antibody directly against IL-6, not the receptor, and then anakinra, which is an IL-1 receptor antagonist that blocks IL-1 signaling. Anakinra was approved almost 20 years ago for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, and is used fairly commonly in systemic JIA, children with systemic features of juvenile inflammatory arthritis, and sometimes in adults with Still's disease. The sarilumab trial that's going on at Northwestern is a multi-center, multinational study. It's a phase 2-3 adaptive design. The phase 2 section is going at the sickest patients, looking at a number of different outcome measures, but primarily looking at a significant morbidity or requirement for ventilatory support, with the plan to move into a phase 3 portion of the trial once they learn something about outcome determination in the first part and expand to some of the less sick patients. It's a fairly straightforward trial. They're using three different arms, a low dose, a high dose, and a placebo arm, and they're a single IV dose of sarilumab. To give you an idea of what they're looking at here, the IV dose that's being given as a single dose here is roughly equivalent to a month's worth of dosing for our patients who have rheumatoid arthritis who are being treated with sarilumab, for which this drug is already approved. In RA, it's given sub-Q. There are a number of challenges in trying to figure out what the endpoints are going to be in managing these patients with cytokine storm syndrome, and I highlighted some. The most important one is trying to figure out what is the clinical course you're trying to intervene in. What are the outcomes that are trying to be prevented? The simplest is obviously mortality, but that's pretty blunt. Other morbidities and other comorbidities may be important, requirement for ICU care, requirement for ventilatory support, et cetera. And I highlighted CRP and fever because I think there's a cautionary note that has to be included in trials, particularly with the IL-6 inhibitor, because we've learned with IL-6 inhibitors in RA that these drugs generate profound reduction in CRP, even in the absence of significant symptomatic relief because of their effect on acute phase reactants. And we've also seen in patients with RA who've had surgery that these drugs interfere with post-op fevers. And so the concern might be that looking at simply some of those markers as a marker of response may just simply be looking at effect of the drug and not really clearance of the infection. Next slide. I'm going to shift gears and talk a little bit about our patients with rheumatic disease. From the very beginning, we have been concerned about our patients with our various diseases, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, systemic sclerosis, et cetera. We've tried to balance the risks of therapy of the disease with the immune consequences of having active underlying disease and what that says in terms of acquiring or COVID-19 infection or having a more serious infection. Our current recommendations and what we've done from the beginning is that patients without infections, we've asked them to continue their current therapy, including any disease-modifying drugs like methotrexate or any biologic therapies. In the setting of an active infection, The current recommendations, and these come from the American College of Rheumatology, have been to continue hydroxychloroquine, but hold all the other DMARDs or biologics, with the possible exception of an IL-6 inhibitor, because of what I just talked about in terms of cytokine storm syndrome. This is all speculative. This is all a group of rheumatologists recommending this. There's no good data, honestly, to support any of these. I will note that infusion therapies have been a particularly challenging issue for us. Many of our patients receive infusions of biologic therapies. These are often the older patients, often the sicker patients. And so the challenge for us has been bringing them in for infusions while worrying about exposure to the virus in the infusion center, either from other patients, from staff, and transmission in this particularly immunocompromised population. We have cut back on the number of infusion chairs we have. We have tried to spread them out. We've begun using exam rooms for infusions, but it's an ongoing issue. And now we're actually starting to face the issue of patients who have an infection but continue to need therapy, and when is it safe to bring them back into the infusion center? And it's something we're continuing to work on. Next slide. From the beginning, we've wondered whether our patients on therapy are sicker, and this is the first report that just came out a few days ago from Italy, from Milan. They looked at 123 patients with connective tissue diseases, mostly lupus, some scleroderma, some Sjogren's syndrome, some undifferentiated. Most of the patients were on disease-modifying drugs, including hydroxychloroquine. 20% were on biologics, a number were on steroids. And they found that the infection rate was not very different from what they were seeing in their region around Milan during the months of February and March when they looked at these patients. A number of them had some respiratory symptoms but weren't tested. They had a single mortality. It was a woman with systemic sclerosis who already had pulmonary disease who was on hydroxychloroquine and rituximab at the time. And their overall conclusion was that there was no sign of increased risk in these patients on these biologic and disease-modifying therapies, and they did not see a protective effect of the hydroxychloroquine. Next slide. We're continuing to accumulate other international data. On the left, there's some data from the COVID-19 Global Rheumatology Alliance. This is a large international database that we contribute to and other centers around the world contribute to as we learn of patients with rheumatologic diseases developing this infection. Main takeaway is that there's a broad spectrum of patients developing infections, including systemic lupus patients on hydroxychloroquine, which raises the question of whether hydroxychloroquine is truly protective. On the other hand, not seeing a huge increase over what we might expect in the number of infections in this population. And on the right is a European database that really came to the same conclusions. The comorbidities seen in these patients are the same comorbidities that we're used to seeing with this infection overall, hypertension, lung disease, cardiovascular disease, and diabetes. Next slide. And then finally, in the last few seconds here, I want to talk a little bit about hydroxychloroquine. This has obviously been a lot in the news lately. A number of different looks at this. The early French so-called study was quite flawed. It wasn't really a study. It compared two groups at two different institutions and concluded that there was benefit in hydroxychloroquine, but a lot of issues with that particular publication. There was a small randomized trial in China that showed no benefit, but the trial was clearly underpowered to see anything. And most recently, we saw a few days ago, a retrospective analysis of patients who were hospitalized at the VA across the country. They looked at patients who were treated with hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, or no therapy at all. And overall, they actually found a higher risk of death in the hydroxychloroquine patients. These were propensity score matched to try to adjust the hazard ratios, but did not see an increased benefit from hydroxychloroquine and increased risk, which led to some recommendation that this may not be appropriate, at least in the hospitalized population. Two other large populations that we've heard about, one in New York across a number of different centers, about 700 patients, no clear benefit from hydroxychloroquine. It was an observational study, and I've heard recently that Columbia University in Manhattan is about to put together their numbers, and they also didn't see a benefit in about 600 patients. These observational studies are not going to give us the final answer, and ultimately, we clearly need controlled data to understand whether this agent's going to help at all. And I'll wrap it up there, turn it over to the other speakers. We'll hold questions for the end, put them in on email, and I'm happy to answer any questions as we get to the end of the program.
Good morning. Hi, I'm Ed Manno. I'm going to be talking about neurological manifestations of COVID-19 or the SARS-CoV-2 virus. All right, so I think what we can talk about is what have we seen so far neurologically with this disease? What information do we have comes primarily from retrospective observational studies, case reports that we have, and this finding that these patients, the severe patients, have this very severe agitated delirium, whether that is secondary to COVID-2 or is that just a process that we are seeing with severe viral pneumonias is unclear. I was talking to Rich Wunderlich about this today or the other day, and many of these patients in the past that had just SARS virus had similar type of presentation. Question is, we don't understand what this is doing neurologically. There are proposed mechanisms of neural invasion and secondary complications that we'll talk about briefly. Obviously, we need prospective studies and analysis and autopsies evaluations in these patients. This is what we have so far in terms of retrospective analysis. And as mentioned previously, it holds all the biases of retrospective analysis. These are patients that were just noted to have COVID that had some type of neurological abnormality. The one that is most quoted is this that was in JAMA Neurology, came out of Wuhan. Now, these were patients that had that were treated at an outside hospital and then sent to the three COVID hospitals that were in Wuhan, China. Of these 214 hospitalized patients, they grouped these neurological manifestations very, very broadly into CNS, PNS, and skeletal muscle injury. And they also grouped them according to the American Thoracic Society guidelines of being having either severe infection or non-severe infection. When they looked at the neurological manifestations, overall, roughly about a third of these patients had CNS manifestations, much more commonly in the patients with severe illness. And primarily what they saw is they saw acute cerebrovascular events, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, impaired consciousness, and muscle injury with severe elevated CKs in these patients. And if you look at, I don't have an arrow here, but if you look on the graph on the right here, these patients appeared to have lower lymphocyte and platelet levels, but really not at a level that you would anticipate would be particularly problematic. As mentioned, we have seen this very, very severe agitated delirium. Eric Liotta, Ayush Batra, and Rich Wunderlich have worked on a sedation protocol. I think as we in the neurology department were worried about this one, somebody said this consulting tsunami that was going to be coming because all of these patients are so severely agitated. Well, this was a letter to the editor that came out in the New England Journal last week. They had noticed this also. They did an observational studies of 58 of consecutive hospitalized patients. The other ones had either died or had stayed on neuromuscular blockade. Seven patients had previous neurological history, and of in many of these patients, when you woke them up, were noted to have severe agitation, delirium, and neurological features. When we looked at that population, they saw that agitation was present in about two-thirds of these patients. If you did a CAM ICU on them, most of them were similarly also had confusion. But most interesting, what you saw in these patients is they had diffuse corticospinal tracts, the reflexes were up, they had ankle clonus, bilateral extensor reflexes, so they had these long track signs. When they did EEGs on these patients, it was relatively nonspecific and the CSF was relatively bland and they were unable to identify any PCR of the virus in the CSF. Most interestingly, of the patients that survived and were discharged, about a third of them had severe cognitive difficulties resulting in disorientation, inattention, and inability to sort of follow complex commands. when I looked at the radiographic imaging in these patients, they saw in 13 of these patients had an MRI, 8 of them had leptomeningeal enhancement. Interestingly, we're seeing it mostly in the posterior fossa. We just got a patient yesterday, a transfer in from Canada, supposedly COVID negative, but is picking off cranial nerves, has an MRI that looks very similar to this. I am very suspicious that this patient is going to turn out to be COVID positive. Similarly, when they've done cerebral blood flow studies, in 11 of 13 of these patients, there's hypoperfusion in the frontal lobe that has been noted in these severely agitated patients. Again, the list of what we're seeing, we'll talk a little bit about the case reports. One of the things I've been concerned about is we've been waiting for this deluge of post-viral Guillain-Barré patients. We haven't seen it yet. There are 5 cases that are reported out of Italy thus far. Three of them were demyelinating, 2 of them were axonal. Unfortunately, thus far, the ones that had the axonal forms have not done well. A couple of these case reports, this is the one that's got the most attention. This came out of Henry Ford of this acute hemorrhagic necrotizing encephalopathy. As you can see, the MR features with it below is a viral meningitis that had been that has been documented. One of the early features that was discovered is the fact that this appears to have olfactory and gustatory dysfunctions that are associated with it. This was a European cohort of 417. These are relatively mild patients, but as you can see from the numbers there, a significant percentage, almost all of them had some degree of olfactory and gustatory dysfunction. And the early recovery rate was only about a half of these patients. And I can tell you this is a really particularly disabling symptom. I had a friend of mine from New York call me. He went through the entire syndrome, thought he was getting better, and then at the very end lost his sense of smell and taste. And he said, you know, I'm in lockdown. The one thing I can do is cook and eat, and I can't even enjoy that with it. This is a letter to the editor that's looked at the prevalence and intensity of this altered sense of smell. And this was in JAMA. And they contacted 283 patients via telephone survey about a week after they had been infected. And they gave this sinonasal outcome test with the unfortunate acronym of the SNOT score. And subsequently, what that score goes from really being non-affected to 5 being you can't really smell or taste pretty much anything. And the majority of these patients leveled out somewhere around severe disorder of 4. And about 6% of these patients reported that it was their only symptom that they had of COVID. Interestingly, we originally thought this was the inciting symptomatology that people have. But more and more we're seeing it can happen anywhere along the course of the disease. So hypothetically, how can this virus get into the CNS? Well, the nasal mucosa has the highest density of ACE2 receptors in the bronchial tree. So obviously you can get this probably through the nose. Is there a direct hematogenous spread either from infection of the endothelial cells that disrupt the blood-brain barrier, or is it a secondary process due to blood-brain barrier breakdown in the setting of this cytochrome storm? Can there be transsynaptic transmission? We don't know that as of yet, and some people have suggested lymphatic system could be involved with this. We do have evidence in a mouse model of another coronavirus. This is the coronavirus OC43, that it can propagate in mouse axons and transsynaptically infect other neurons. Similarly, what we've seen in transgenic mice for the ACE2 receptors, that if you inoculate these mice, and you can see an ENF here, that this is naive hypothalamus and brainstem, that there is viral antigen in the SARS-CoV mouse that you can see that these areas are infected. And in particular, if you look at the brainstem areas of these mice that are infected, it's infected in the area postrema, the dorsal motor nucleus. I won't go into great neuroanatomy detail, but suffice to say that these are areas that can have profound cardiorespiratory effects. There's also been documentation of the SARS-CoV-1 in humans in eight patients where they have autopsies. They can see that there have been scattered neurons throughout the cerebrum and also in the brainstem. So can we have direct neural invasion into these respiratory centers? We don't know. Certainly, hypothetically, it could happen. It is very, very interesting. Many of these patients develop this almost type of neurogenic respiratory pattern. It's a relatively rare pattern, seen extraordinarily uncommonly. I've seen it only twice in my career with direct lymphomatous involvement in these centers and with the case of Irvine-Chester disease, but these are patients that will blow their PCO2s down into the single digits and start seizing. There are reports patients that will breathe at this level and have no sense of dyspnea. They don't have any sense that anything's wrong with them. And there is at least one report of a patient with complete loss of voluntary respiration with this. What about cerebrovascular disease? There is a noted hypercoagulable state. Dr. Zakarija, I will let's speak to that. I will just tell you that I have heard of, and we are going to hear of this week, five COVID patients that they are presenting with large vessel occlusions that went to thrombectomy. The interesting part about this is they all were in their 30s and 40s and had absolutely no co-risk factors. So it may be that acute stroke is actually a presenting sign of COVID. Obviously, there's much needed work. Literally, as mentioned before, this is changing on a daily basis and something that we all need to keep up with. So I tried to stay on time, and I'll pass this over to Dr. Zakarija and take questions on the end.
Thank you, Dr. Manno, and thanks to everyone for allowing me to participate on behalf of the Benign Hematology Group here at Northwestern, our perspectives on hematology and COVID-19. As we all know, information is rapidly evolving in this area, but we do know that hematologic abnormalities are a prominent feature of COVID-19 disease. In particular, a majority of hospitalized patients present with coagulopathy, which is manifest by an elevation in D-dimer and fibrinogen, but most patients do not have overt DIC. PT and PTT are normal, and bleeding is quite uncommon. Thrombocytopenia is very mild. But this elevation in D-dimer has been significant and has been associated with a significant increased risk in mortality. In addition, as heard in the past and today also, thrombotic events are a primary feature of patients with this disorder, and I will spend a lot of my time today discussing this. What do we know about thrombotic complications in COVID-19 disease? We know that in hospitalized patients, many different forms of thromboses have been apparent. Dr. Kutica presented a little review of venous thrombosis in this patient population a few weeks ago during Grand Grounds. We still find the studies coming out of China and Europe at this point now indicate anywhere from 20 to 30% of patients will develop a thrombotic event during their hospitalization, and some of these despite thromboprophylaxis. Other thrombotic events are also being seen, arterial events, both cerebral and myocardial infarcts in a smaller proportion of patients, but still significant, though the true prevalence of this is not well understood. Microvascular thrombi are also being seen on skin biopsy in patients with severe COVID. And as mentioned before, this D-dimer is markedly elevated, which is an indication of coagulation activation, but is really not very specific for VTE, and most patients with elevated D-dimers will not actually be found to have a thrombotic event that we can see on standard imaging. But this phenomenon has raised the question of, do we need to intervene? Do these patients need to be treated differently? In addition, in just the last week, I think we've heard more and more, particularly in the lay press, about thrombotic complications occurring in patients with mild disease. This has included case reports of levito reticularis and COVID toes. This is not clear if this is actually a vasculitis or manifestation of microthrombi, but has been concerning. And as Dr. Manno just mentioned, this report is coming out this week about strokes in young patients. And we've all heard about that in the lay press. And really, this is a feature of practicing in this 21st century epidemic, is that we're seeing information come out in the lay press before we actually see it in the medical press. So patients are concerned, we are concerned as physicians, but really the data and the true prevalence of these complications is not really well understood. So two central questions really come up when we think about hypercoagulability and COVID-19. Is infection with this SARS-CoV-2 virus really associated with a higher thrombotic potential than other infections? And is the COVID-19 associated sepsis more hypercoagulable? We really don't have the data to answer that question, but we need to treat these patients, and what should our treatment approach be? Should it be different than our standard of care? We know that thrombosis is a prominent feature of infection. And this is because thrombosis is an early defense mechanism in innate immunity. The coagulation system, the immune cells, and platelets all work together to limit dissemination of a pathogen. But excessive coagulation and ultimately sepsis-associated DICs contribute significantly to the morbidity in these infections. We know that pro-inflammatory cytokines can tip this balance. They decrease and impair natural anticoagulant pathways and also decrease fibrinolysis. And in particular, with the SARS-CoV-2 virus, binding to the ACE2 receptor, actually through the renin-angiotensin system, results in an increase in PAI-1, effectively decreasing fibrinolysis and possibly tipping the balance over into more significant coagulopathy. Therefore, how can we treat these patients? Historically, anticoagulants have been studied in a number of situations in sepsis and not found to really improve mortality in sepsis. But people have always wondered, is there a subset of patients that really would benefit from targeting this system? What do we know about COVID and targeting the anticoagulant system in particular? We do know actually some early studies out of Italy demonstrating that patients on heparin, even low doses of heparin, have decreases in the inflammatory markers. And a study out of China has demonstrated that there's a lower mortality in patients who actually are receiving heparin prophylaxis, particularly in those patients with markedly elevated D-dimers or sepsis coagulopathy scores that are elevated. So therefore, this thromboinflammatory system really is an important target in just treating the comorbidities associated with this disease. Further, many clinical trials are now ongoing in this area, but they target, you know, include anticoagulants, immunomodulatory therapies, complement inhibitors also, and potentially even PAI-1 inhibitors. So there are many practical questions that have come up in treating these patients. In particular, who should get thromboprophylaxis and maybe with what agent? And another important question, are there some patients without proven VTE that would benefit from therapeutic anticoagulation? These questions have come up, of course, as we've tried to take care of these patients, and informal discussions of these questions led a multidisciplinary group to convene and to really develop VTE prophylaxis guidance for our institution here at Northwestern. These will be soon available on NMI sometime this week, and we will update them as more information becomes available. Of course, this guidance is based on consensus, as really the data is not here yet as to how we should really optimally treat these patients. But some of the key recommendations from this guidance include all patients should receive VTE prophylaxis as long as the bleeding risk is low. but we have made some modifications to what our standard of care is, and that is in patients who may be perceived to be at higher risk of VTE, there is a consideration to use an intermediate prophylactic dose, such as enoxaparin BID. This is based on clinical trials in other settings in patients with critical illness and also in the orthopedic surgery population. In addition, the guidance will and recommends dosing recommendations for obese patients, as we know that standard thromboprophylaxis in this patient population is suboptimal. Now, another important point that the guidance addresses is the recommendation that no empiric therapeutic anticoagulation should be given in the absence of thrombosis, unless, of course, there is a high clinical suspicion and the inability to do diagnostic testing. Now, there are centers around the country that have adopted an approach of therapeutically anticoagulating patients just based on an elevated D-dimer without any evidence of thrombosis. Our group did not feel that the evidence really warranted this recommendation, and there is concern about potential bleeding risks in this patient population. Finally, as patients are discharged, we must consider that they also may continue to be at some risk for thrombosis. And so there is the recommendation to consider post-discharge prophylaxis, especially if there are additional risk factors for VTE present, and such as a patient being intubated for COVID, or if there's evidence of ongoing inflammation at the time of discharge. Now, the guidance doesn't really address which anticoagulant we should choose, but there are some things to consider. Of course, in a critically ill patient, the heparins may be more optimal as they can be, their dosing can be changed rapidly. And also the heparins do have some anti-inflammatory effects of, as I've discussed, but really there is not enough evidence to suggest that these have to be used or are the ideal agents in this situation. DOACs can still be used. They do offer the advantage of ease of administration and less provider contact for administration to patients. But in a critically ill patient, again, they may not be optimal. Finally, there are a number of investigational agents being used in the treatment of COVID, and I want to point out a resource that's been developed by a group out of Liverpool, and the website is right there. And actually, they address drug-drug interactions, not just with anticoagulants, but with a number of other therapies that, and their interactions with the COVID therapies. I want to highlight a few other efforts here at Northwestern in regards to answering some of these questions, as data is clearly needed in this area. Dr. Kwan is heading up a retrospective review of COVID patients and coagulopathy. We're also led by Dr. Carlin Martin here at Northwestern as the local PI. She's looking at bringing an interesting prospective clinical trial to patients here. This is a multi-institution trial that really addresses the question of, do patients with an elevated D-dimer need more aggressive therapy? This will be a clinical trial for non-ICU COVID patients with D-dimers greater than 2 times the upper limit of normal, and therapy will be randomization to either therapeutic anticoagulation or just standard prophylactic anticoagulation. And the primary composite outcomes are listed here. So we look forward to results from this trial and other trials that are happening around the world at this point to really address what is the optimal therapy for COVID coagulopathy, as it really seems to impart a significant morbidity in this patient population. I want to switch gears a little bit and just acknowledge another area in the hospital and a group of nurses that have done extraordinary work. This is the center, the Rube Walker Blood Center, which has provided the essential services of transfusions and apheresis to patients during these trying times. In addition, I want to talk a few minutes about sickle cell disease, actually, and COVID. Currently, there are no data on the outcomes of sickle cell disease patients in this infection. But we do know with the propensity for sickle cell disease to lead to acute chest syndrome and the vaso-occlusive nature of this disease, we do are concerned that there would be an increased morbidity in this patient population. Therefore, early red blood cell exchange may be an important component of therapy. Here at Northwestern so far, we have treated 2 patients with sickle cell disease who had COVID pneumonia and took them to early red blood cell exchange. It is still early, but we are hopeful that early institution of red blood cell exchange will improve the outcomes in these patients. Registries are ongoing to collect this kind of data. The other aspect of apheresis that's been raised in treatment of COVID is the potential use of therapeutic plasma exchange. Now, for years, therapeutic plasma exchange in the past has been studied in critical illness and sepsis, but did not show a mortality benefit, though there are some anecdotal reports of TPE being used during the H1N1 influenza outbreak. Here's one of the potential downsides of apheresis, that it does have the potential to remove any therapeutic drug that is also being utilized. But this is an area of potential clinical research, and we are in particular looking at the possibility of participating in a clinical trial that uses apheresis with an absorption column to reduce these pro-inflammatory cytokines. So here we are practicing in this 21st century pandemic, and there are pros and cons to this. This will not be the Spanish flu for many reasons, and we have rapid dissemination of information. We're learning every day more and more about this disease. But all of us struggle to process this information, which is really coming at us at an incredible speed, and we have to make decisions about treatment without having all the information. In addition, anecdotes tend to drive us sometimes to make decisions that may not be optimal. So we really need evidence-based recommendations, but care of patients does not wait for this. But truly, in this stage, when infrastructure is there to do this, we really should attempt to conduct non-standard of care practices as part of clinical research. I just want to acknowledge the faculty in benign heme and all of the staff that support us, and the hospital and division and department leadership, which have allowed us to care for these patients. I just want to end with a little quote and a reflection that I have, that with science, we will unravel this mystery, tame the virus, and treat the patients so that we can go back to practicing the medicine that we love, diagnosing, educating, guiding, and comforting patients with a steady voice, a smile on our face, and a healing touch. Thank you. Okay, now I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Hanauer.
Morning. Indeed, it's an honor to represent the GI division in a discussion of how SARS-CoV-2 affects the GI tract. And I'll focus my discussion at the end on this at-risk or vulnerable patients with inflammatory bowel disease. The learning objectives for today are to discuss the pathogenesis of SARS-CoV-2 with a focus on the GI tract, and to review the potential impact of the inflammatory bowel disease medications on the risk and also the treatment of the disease. And to do that, we're going to review some of the real world data based on some international registry that has been developed, and subsequently a RAND panel discussion of international IBD experts. We've heard many times now that the virus enters through the nose, mouth, and eyes and attaches to cells in the upper airway, and we just learned today about the nasopharyngeal airway as well. The ACE2 receptor is found in multiple organs, and including the GI tract, and has also been found in the stool, which we will talk about in a moment. It has also been noted that there are frequent GI manifestations in many of these patients. This slide demonstrates the fact that there are ACE2 receptors that are present in the stomach, the duodenum, and in the colon. And indeed, the viral nuclear protein has also been demonstrated throughout the mucosa of the GI tract from the stomach into the colon as well. Reports from China and from Europe have documented that there are gastrointestinal symptoms that are quite frequent, spanning from, as we've heard today again, loss of sense of taste or smell that may precede, accompany other symptoms, or present alone. Anorexia is, of course, common, as well as mild symptoms of diarrhea or abdominal pain. Likewise, as I mentioned, the stool does incorporate viral RNA, but this does not confirm that the particles in the stool are infectious and capable of disease transmission. Indeed, in comparison of viral shedding in aggregated samples from the oropharynx and the nasopharynx, respiratory samples and stool samples have demonstrated that viral RNA can be identified in the stool for up to 22 days after negative nasal swabs. However, this does not mean that the virus is actually replicating. And on this slide, we can see that there is subgenomic viral DNA, RNA, in relationship to the full virus. And indeed, it is the RNA that is shed rather than living and replicating viruses. There are also ACE2 receptors present in cholangiocytes of the liver and within the acinar cells of the pancreas. And we have seen, in general, mild liver enzyme abnormalities that are quite frequent in these patients, but it is usually transient. Low serum albumin has been a marker of COVID severity. And there have been rare cases of severe acute hepatitis. Similarly, there are mild manifestations of pancreatitis in up to 20% of patients manifest as abnormal lipase or amylase. But severe pancreatitis has not been common. And it looks like these are manifestations that are not necessarily representative of severe disease in either the liver or in the pancreas. Now, to focus on my and our inflammatory bowel disease population, a population that is frequently treated with corticosteroids, immunomodifiers such as thiopurines or methotrexates, biologic therapies, including anti-TNF therapies, anti-adhesion molecules, and other anti-cytokines. And ultimately, in very severe cases, patients can be treated with the JAK inhibitor tofacitinib or cyclosporine. Now, when we look at these drugs and try to make recommendations for prevention or for treatment, it's been recognized that many of the therapies that we are using, including corticosteroids, thiopurines, methotrexates, and most of the biologics, as well as the non-biologic tofacitinib, have been associated with an increased risk of viral infections. But I've been thinking about this, and the primary manifestation of viral infections that have been reported with these immunomodulatory therapies have been reactivation of herpes zoster or reactivation of hepatitis B. And that makes me think whether or not this is actually a susceptibility of reactivation or actually a risk factor for primary infections. In addition, low lymphocyte counts, as we've just heard and have heard before, has been associated with increased death from coronavirus. But that begs the question as to whether or not lymphopenia prior to exposure to COVID-19 actually increases the risk of either the infection or complications from the infection, as indeed medications such as azathioprine or mercaptopurine, sometimes methotrexate, or corticosteroids can lead to reductions in baseline lymphocyte counts. So the key questions are whether or not patients with IBD are at greater risk of COVID-19 manifestations of SARS, or whether we should be modifying the immunosuppression in these patients preceding or in the setting of active disease. So along these lines, at the very beginning of the pandemic, a variety of international IBD organizations, including the International Organization of IBD, the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation in the US, the pediatric groups, the European groups, the Asian groups, have come together to develop what's known as the Secure IBD database that is readily accessible at covidibd.org, which is an international registry of patients from around the world, as you see. In yellow are the reported cases, and in red are the reported deaths. Now, this is based on 770 patients entered into the registry as of 2 days ago. 251 had been hospitalized. As you can see, there were 29 deaths. But just as we heard from Eric Ruderman in the RA population, it appears that the risk factors for COVID infections and COVID complications are the same as in the general population. Now, the IBD population is inherently younger than the rheumatoid arthritis population, but you can see based on this registry that the primary risks of death were actually age-related, and in addition, not shown is the addition of comorbidities, just as we saw with the rheumatoid arthritis population. And on the next slide, we can actually see data related to the individual immunomodulatory agents. From the far left, sulfasalazine and mesalamine, and you can see throughout a spectrum of individual or combination therapies. And within these, we do not see any spike that signifies a particular risk of COVID-19 hospitalization or death dependent on the medications the patients were taking preceding this. And similar to the rheumatoid arthritis groups, the International Organization of IBD has prepared a RAND panel analysis of recommendations that is not evidence-based, but is instead based on expert opinion. And what you can see from this in green is the medications that can be should be discontinued is primarily corticosteroids preceding infections. In patients who are not infected and not at risk, we do not make any recommendations as far as changing medication. And we alerted our patient population to this 6 weeks ago to stay on their medication. However, there's more debate as to what drugs should be continued or discontinued in the advent of a COVID infection or complications. In general, primarily corticosteroids should be reduced if possible, and immunomodulatory drugs in the case of an infection. However, as I showed you previously, the half-life of many of these drugs, including the biologics, is several weeks and will persist throughout that. So in summary, although ACE2 expression is common in the GI tract, COVID-19 symptoms and signs of GI tract manifestations are generally mild, and the IBD patients who are considered at risk really seem to have the same risk as the general population, with increased morbidity and mortality according to age, and minimal evidence of risk from individual therapies. So with this, I would like to acknowledge our Digestive Health Center front staff and the NMH front staff, as well as our DHC leadership with John Panofino, Scott Strong from colorectal surgery, and Chris Stevoff, who is directing our outpatient clinics. And of exceeding importance are Sri Komandori and Raj Keswani, as well as the DHC administration. Our hospital administration has not received enough credit for our ongoing management. And my final comments are, you heard Dr. Manno talk about the sino-nasal outcome test or the SNOT test for ENT. We are considering a GI proposed symptom index known as the coronavirus-related abdominal problems or CRAP. And with that, I want to thank you.
All right, good morning. I'm going to be the last of the organ system tour regarding coronavirus, and I'm going to focus on obesity and what we know about its link to COVID-19. Obesity has been in the news recently because of the publication of several online studies. I'm going to review them momentarily, but I first want to start with, what do we know about obesity? Why would we think it would be a risk factor for worsening symptoms, hospitalization, intensive care, admission, and so forth for patients with obesity who develop COVID-19. Next slide, please. So this is what we know already. We know there's an increased prevalence of chronic diseases that obesity drives, particularly diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, obstructive sleep apnea, and some of these have already been identified as occurring more often in patients who are hospitalized with COVID-19. We also know that among some individuals with obesity, particularly those with abdominal obesity or visceral obesity, there is an increased risk or prevalence of hyperglycemia and insulin resistance, of course, would be linking to diabetes right there, as well as a chronic state of low-grade inflammation from increased pro-inflammatory cytokines and adipokines. And we've heard about these on multiple presentations in Grand Rounds, CRP, IL-6, TNF-alpha. And there's also a prothrombotic state, and we just heard about the increased risk of thrombosis in these individuals. The CDC published a paper called People Who Are at Higher Risk for COVID-19, and among those risk factors is listed severe obesity, which we define as a body mass index of 40 or greater. The data that is emerging, which I will show you, suggests to me that that risk will be lowered to below 40 and potentially include all individuals with obesity. A recent study that came out in JAMA Online last week by Richardson and others, in which they looked at 5,700 patients hospitalized with COVID-19 in New York, 41.7% had obesity, that is a BMI of over 30, and that was second only to hypertension and then followed by diabetes. And we also know from experience from the 2009 influenza A H1N1 pandemic that obesity was identified as a risk factor for increased morbidity and mortality with an odds ratio of 1.67 to 2 for fatal or critical complications. And just as a denominator so that you are aware, in the United States, the prevalence of obesity among U.S. adults is 42.4%, and those with severe obesity is 9.2% of adults. Next slide, please. We also know that obesity is a risk factor in the ICU and all of the intensivists and hospitalists and everyone else who's volunteering to take care of these individuals are well aware of these challenges, but I want to review them for all of us who are not in the ICU. These patients often come in with impaired ventilation, particularly those with abdominal obesity, due to respiratory compromise or reduced lung compliance, functional residual compliance, capacity, and expiratory reserve volume. They often have comorbid conditions of sleep apnea, obesity, hypoventilation syndrome, which is also called Pickwickian syndrome. They have difficult airway management because of the size of their neck or their face. It may be difficult to ventilate them with a mask, as well as a crowded pharynx, which would cause difficulty with intubation. There's also a challenge of proning, which is often used in these individuals, similar to patients with pregnancy. Those with abdominal obesity may be difficult to prone as well as to position. There's also diagnostic imaging issues. There's weight limits and size limits on CAT scans and other imaging procedures that are often called use in these individuals. And lastly, management issues, transportation equipment, positioning, large wheelchairs, bariatric beds and so forth, depending on the size of the individuals. For these reasons, they're quite a challenge. Next slide, please. What I'd like to do over the next three slides is to show you the data that is published online that shed a light on the risk of obesity. The first one is a study from Petrelli, which is data from NUI Langone Health, which is collected from March 1st to April 2nd. In which 7,700 patients were tested for COVID-19, of which almost half tested positive. Now, of those who tested positive, about half were hospitalized, and 40% of those patients experienced critical illness. And critical illness in this study was defined as a composite of care in the ICU, use of mechanical ventilation, discharge to hospice, or death, and turned out that about 18% actually were discharged to hospice or died. Now, the primary outcome of this study was to identify predictors for hospitalization and critical illness. And on the top table, it shows the multivariate regression results for hospitalization. On the bottom is for critical illness. And I just pulled out to shine the light on the data on obesity. The table in this study actually looks at all the comorbidities, but here I'm looking just at obesity. And what you could see is that for hospitalization, there's a significantly increased odds ratio for those that have BMI as low as 30 with an odds ratio of over 4, BMI of over 40, the odds ratio is 6 to come into the hospital. And for critical illness, you also see a significant increase in odds ratio, 1.4 roughly for a BMI of 30 to 40, and then 1.7 for those with 40 or greater. The predictors of hospitalization from this study were advanced age, obesity, history of heart failure, and chronic kidney disease. Next slide, please. This is the second of three studies I want to present, all published online. This study comes from France. It's a single center retrospective cohort study in which all consecutive patients were admitted to the ICU for COVID-19, and data was between February 27th and April 5th. The primary outcome was to determine the prevalence of patients receiving mechanical ventilation according to BMI classification. They had 124 patients admitted, and they also used a cohort of non-COVID-19 patients who were admitted to their ICU in 2019 as their control group. They had 306 there. And I'm showing you three different figures. Figure A shows the percent of patients by BMI classification of COVID-19 patients versus those of non-COVID-19 patients from 2019. So what you can see is an increase in those admitted to the ICU with higher BMI classifications. In figure B, you see the percent of COVID-19 patients who received mechanical ventilation by BMI classification, either they did or did not receive mechanical ventilation. Again, you can see those that received mechanical ventilation had a much higher percentage of BMI of 35 or greater and so forth. And lastly, in panel C, it's the percent of COVID-19 patients stratified by BMI classification who received mechanical ventilation. Again, the higher percentage of those with a higher BMI. Although not shown here, a BMI of greater than 35 and an odds ratio of 7.4 for requiring mechanical ventilation compared to a BMI less than 25, and that was the most predictive variable. Next slide, please. And the last study, which is published online, also got a lot of press, is from Leiter, also from NYU Langone Health. And this was a retrospective analysis of COVID-19 symptomatic patients who received critical care. And they defined critical care as being admitted to the ICU or mechanical ventilation. And their data was collected between March 4th and April 4th. Of the 3,600 individuals who were tested positive for COVID-19, 21% had a BMI of 30 to 34, and 16% had a BMI of greater than 35, is those patients that received further analysis. So the investigators looked at the percent of patients who were hospitalized and the percent who were admitted to the ICU compared to discharge from the ED. This is a study that got a lot of press and I think is potentially alarm signal for those individuals in our population who are not at advanced age, and this study defines less than 60. And they divide. So what you see here on the top panel is that among those individuals who are greater than 60, there was really no difference in admission to the hospital or admission to the ICU compared to those who went home from the ED by BMI stratification. It was only those less than 60 years old where you see really a significant difference in odds ratio for being admitted to the hospital or to the ICU. Next slide. I want to end with a shout out to all of the ambulatory care clinicians who are doing telemedicine with our patients. This is an extremely stressful time for all of our patients. It is not normal, and all of them are experiencing stress. And I would recommend, if possible and time allows, that all of our clinicians who are doing telehealth talk about empowerment of health for our patients staying at home. And for all of the clinicians working with medical students, this is a wonderful opportunity for medical students to promote lifestyle medicine for our patients. Patients need to establish a daily schedule to incorporate their health behaviors. They need to set meal and snack times. They need to plan them in advance and choose nutritious foods. Keep highly processed foods and tempting foods out of the house. And this, by the way, is not just for patients with obesity, it's for individuals who may cope with food. I have found that when they're no longer going to the restaurants and having snacks at the workplace, patients are learning to prepare foods on their own, working off of a shopping list, and developing new skills they did not previously have an opportunity to express. It's also very important to schedule daily physical activity by walking or using videos or virtual classes, home equipment, resistance bands, doing calisthenics at home, also setting the alarm setting the alarm to stand every hour to reduce sedentary behavior. This all boosts immunity. Get adequate sleep, set an alarm for wake time and for bedtime. De-stressing is important for all of us, not just patients who are struggling with their weight. I think it's important to unplug from the 24-hour news cycle, use relaxation apps, read, listen to music, engage in projects, games, and hobbies, dance at home like my wife and I do, stay connected with family and friends, and lastly, to encourage self-empowerment to improve health and well-being. Next slide, which is my last. I just want to conclude, what do we know, what have we learned, and what are the future research questions? We know that obesity increases the risk for COVID-19 hospitalizations and admission to the ICU. It's likely due to the underlying pathophysiology of adipose tissue, which is associated with systemic inflammation, a prothrombotic milieu, and associated burden of comorbid conditions, particularly diabetes, hypertension, and cardiovascular disease. They also pose greater management challenges, as I've listed here, for ICU management. So what are the future questions? We clearly need to evaluate further our younger patients with obesity. These are patients not likely to have comorbid conditions, which probably highlights the underlying risk factor of obesity itself. We do need, however, to differentiate further between obesity risk and comorbid conditions. We've learned a lot, heard a lot previously about social determinants of health in our minority populations. Of course, that is the population that has a higher prevalence of obesity, and I think we need to understand more about that. And lastly, the impact of other associated factors that may lead to obesity, such as diet, physical inactivity, and there's also some literature on low vitamin D levels and inflammatory response. Lastly, although not on the slide, when a vaccination is developed, what is the efficacy of vaccination in our patients with obesity, viral shedding, and so forth? So with that last slide, I'll turn it back to the moderators. Thank you.